out will be forever the myth.
You're the king of kings, though.
There's always a pecking order. The little peckers never mess with the big peckers. So I'm a rooster, and he's a chicken, so to speak.
All right, welcome back to the Bodybuilding Legends Podcast, and my special guest this week is Mr. Tom Terwilliger. Tom was the 1986 NPC Nationals Light Heavyweight Champion, and he went on to compete in many pro shows, including the Mr. Olympia. And our topic today, Tom, is something you were very good at, which was posing. So I saw a post recently by Sean Ray, and Sean was talking about the 1988 Olympia. And he was talking about in that show how great all the posing was. And even guys who weren't known for their posing really put in the effort and tried to really make great posing routines. And you were known always for your posing, especially, we'll get to this later, the 89 Olympia, where you really came up with this great routine. So I wanted to bring you on so we could talk about that.
Absolutely. I wish Sean could be here joining us. And maybe we'll do this again sometime with him and kind of reminisce a little bit about, because it's great to bounce these things around. And you're terrific at this as well, because you know the era. And the era I'm talking about, of course, is the 80s and even into the 90s, because many of the great bodybuilders that came up the amateur ranks in the 80s were the top pros into the 90s.
Right.
And again, I think certainly there's a lot of commonality there. And much of it, of course, is being reflected in today's classic physique pursuits, you might say, right? It was different lines. It was different symmetry. There was something aesthetically, really aesthetically appealing, that was coming out of that era. Certainly, even before that. Yeah. But I think the '80s, in many respects, personified that classic physique look with a little more refined, perhaps, than the '60s or the '70s, with the lines and the Frank Zanes really kind of brought it to life. But the 80s kind of started to refine it. It was a little more muscularity and the same level of symmetry and proportion as a result. But again, this other commonality was the posing. Was that, and this is perhaps one of the reasons why I was compelled for many reasons to really work hard and try and excel in terms of the posing. And I'll share some of those reasons. But a good part of it had to be because freaking everybody was good.
Yeah, everybody
posed. I mean, in my opinion, it's like, and listen, I hope I'm not selling anyone short. If I am, forgive me. When I talk about no one today is really stepping up to that level, I'm sure, since I'm not completely informed and watching everyone that's competing on either the classic physique or the bodybuilding stage today at the highest level, that there are those who are stepping up and really putting a focus and emphasis on it. So forgive me when I say, no one today, the best today in posing wouldn't even compare to the worst poser
right.
in the 80s. Because everybody put an emphasis on it, you know?
Yeah, that was Sean's point, I think, is that in the 1980s, it was like everybody wanted to do that. So, Tom, we just did an interview with you recently where we were giving a tribute to Mr. Bob Gruskin, who passed away. And we had you and Jerry Scalise and John Defendis on. And you guys were talking about your early days when you started as teenagers in the 1970s. So let's go back to that. And when you did your first show, what was your posing routine like and what were your influences then?
Well, certainly my influence, the greatest influence in my posing, bar none, was on, and I can't remember the exact year, but I think I started competing in around 76 or 77, I think. I think it was 77. In fact, John Defendis and I competed in a couple of the same shows. We didn't know each other at the time. But when I went to see the opening of Pumping Iron in Manhattan, and I tell you something, I was a punk-ass teenage kid who was doing a little working out because I wanted to be a little bit more strong. I wanted to be a little bit more of an athlete for lacrosse. And some of my fellow lacrosse players in junior high school were like joining me on this. It was like, we had a couple of gyms in this guy's basement. We had a gym in this guy's basement, just some dumbbells and stuff like that.
Right.
And we were working out and we saw, somebody showed me the magazine, came to my locker and says, you got to see this, man. I think it was Tom Mahoney, a friend of mine, and he said, you got to see this. And it was Muscle Builder magazine, and had the cover, on the cover was Arnold Schwarzenegger, you know, with his arm blaster on, and he's doing his like, curl. I was like, what in hell? And I sort of flipping through his page, like, holy crap. It took the training to another level. It completely changed my focus, completely. And in those pages, they were talking about a movie that was just coming out, Pumping Iron.
Yeah.
And that it was going to be, oh, it was actually in that Muscle and Fitness magazine, Muscular Development magazine. And it was talking about it was going to be opening in Manhattan and where it was. So here I was with my buddies. It was about six or seven of us. And we were maybe 15 years old, you know, somewhere in that area. And admittedly, we smoke a bunch of dope. We jump on the Long Island Railroad. We go to the theater and we sit down and we're like not expecting much. And then before the movie, they had like four or five guest posers.
Yeah.
There was Lou Ferrigno, I think Robbie Robinson, a couple others. But the routine, and the guy wasn't even in his best shape. By far. I mean, he was in decent shape, but not even really good shape. Ed Corney.
Right.
And Ed Corney's posing just sent shivers up my spine. And it was from that moment, it made such an impression on me at that early age that as much as I wanted the muscle, it was like in my mind, I wanted to move an audience. I wanted to move people's minds and their spirits and their emotion the way he moved me.
Yeah.
I don't know if it had the same impact. I doubt it had the same impact on my fellow travelers, my theater goers, because none of them wound up pursuing it at the same level that I did. But clearly it was a life-altering experience for me to not just see those guys and then to watch the movie. The movie just was the catalyst to it all, you know?
So you guys go to see this movie, and before the movie, they had these guys come out and guest pose.
Live guest posing.
Wow. Did they pose the music, or did they just come out and pose?
No, they posed the music. And in fact, I think Ed Corney posed to 2001 Space Odyssey. Remember? I mean, that was like, everybody in those days wanted to pose to that.
Right.
But he owned it.
Yeah.
He owned it. He was in, and again, I don't recognize it as much. You know, maybe he wasn't even close to the zone, but he was like present. He was in it. He was part, and the way he moved and just turned and the music. And I was just like, oh my God. As a teenager, it was embedded in every cell of my body. And it was something that just moved me to be able to, not just for myself, but to create an experience for an audience, you know, and I, to this day, I think that along with some other experiences, the movie itself was the catalyst to pursuing it to the level I did. But certainly,
cool. You know, I remember reading about that they were doing posing exhibitions in New York at certain shows. This wasn't the premiere, right? This was just a regular showing.
Actually, no, this was the premiere. This was the premiere. And I don't know if it was premiering anywhere else, but it was New York. It was the New York premiere of Pumping Iron.
Okay.
Yep. So it was the first time anyone had seen, you know, in a large audience had seen the movie.
Yeah.
And to promote it, they were having all these guys there, you know.
Right, right.
It was pretty cool.
Yeah, I remember reading the magazines back then, and I remember Ed Corney talking about that, how he had a pose at all these theater shows.
Yeah. This was the opening in Manhattan. So, and again, I wasn't, you know, I didn't go to Manhattan a lot. I was living in Long Island, so it was a bit of a trek, you know, but I had to go, man.
Oh,
I had
to be there,
and I was so glad I did.
Yeah. No. So when you did go ahead, Tom.
I'm sorry.
When you did your first teenage show, what kind of posing routine did you do, having been influenced by that?
I want to look back and say it was magnificent, but I'm sure it was, I'm sure it was as clumsy and amateur as anybody's.
Yeah.
But maybe a step up because of that influence, you know? Yeah. I look back now and I look at some of the pictures. Even with me and John Defendez at the Suburban, which I think was the first competition I did. It was at a small YMCA in East Orange, New Jersey. It was about an hour and a half drive from Long Island. And, you know, I mean, just, and again, it's kind of interesting to think back to and have been part of a time when it was just out of its infancy in many respects, you know. And this was AAU at the time, American Athletic Union. And the auditorium was a basketball gym floor, you know, and they had a little podium with just a little spotlight overhead. It was like a simple light, and that was it. there was no pump up room. There's some curtains that you could pump up a little behind, being backstage.
Yeah.
And
that was the same year, right, Tom? Was that 77?
That was 77.
Yeah, same year the movie came out, yeah.
Yeah, exactly. So it was the same year. And I'd already been working out for like I said, for lacrosse. So it was like, take it up to the next level. Join the gym. That was another inspiration, joining a real gym called Future Man and being inspired by a great champion, Tony Pandolfo.
Yeah.
But when I look back at those pictures, John, I can see that there was some effort going into the posing. And part of that might have been, because I hadn't really been working with Bob Gruskin yet, but I was working a little bit with Tony Pandolfo. I was watching. I was observing. I was looking at guys in the magazine. Certainly Frank Zane was one of my inspirations. So I can even see from those early pictures, you know, the angle, you know, the double bicep with the angle, the hip out. And it was just like,
yeah,
that wasn't just like, oh, didn't up do like this straight, you know, just like there was some effort going into it, you know. So I don't particularly remember the routine. I'm sure it was a basic, this one here. And I know I did a twisting back shot. I did some kind of vacuum, some things that might have been a little unusual, but not terribly unusual. But I think what made the difference even then was, and I should say this, that I had a lot of earlier kung fu training. I had trained in Chinese Kung Fu from the time I was about 8 years old until about that time when I discovered bodybuilding, because the interest in bodybuilding kind of usurped my interest in Kung Fu at that time. Right. It sort of took its place. But the ability to be able to move, to do the Tai Chi, the Kung Fu movement, all translated into the posing. So I think that even though the basic movements were just that, basic, I think the transitions were something a little probably above and beyond, but certainly nothing great, I don't think.
Did you pick out like certain professional bodybuilders that you were trying to imitate them? Like, did you get certain poses from some of the guys?
Yeah, and that's a great, that's a student question that would only come from another bodybuilder who's done the same thing. Because right. That's exactly, right? I mean, is what we had to do.
Yeah.
And I think the mistakes some of the guys were making was like the mistake I would have or could have made would be trying to pose like Arnold or look like Arnold.
Yeah.
I don't have that physique. I don't have that body. Right. I couldn't do Franco Colombo, you know? It's just like,
yeah.
So I was very fortunate that also around that time that Frank Zane was emerging as a Mr. Olympia and one of the top competitors, you know?
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, being about 185 pounds, same height, similar stature, that I was like, okay. So I started studying how he poses, how he shapes, how he creates this illusion, you might say, you know?
Yeah.
And so started, absolutely. And just literally in my mirror in the basement, looking at the pictures, comparing what I'm doing, at the pictures, comparing what I'm doing. And so absolutely influenced by several of them, but certainly Frank Zane was the early influence in terms of the actual poses themselves.
Yeah. Yeah. I've coached people with posing, and I think one of the mistakes that a lot of people make is they see a bodybuilder back in the magazines when we used to see, or probably now on YouTube, and they'll see a pose they do and they go, oh, I love that pose, but that pose doesn't fit their physique. You know, like they might try to do a vacuum pose, but maybe they might not look good in a vacuum pose.
Yeah.
Or they might try to do a most muscular type pose, but they might have more of a Frank Zane type physique, so it doesn't look good on that, you know.
Yeah, absolutely.
So that's right. I think that's
that key. Classic most muscular, unless you're thick.
Yeah,
it just doesn't work. Do something. No. You do find one that does. I mean, Frank Zane. You never saw Frank Zane do that.
No, very rarely.
Did the hands on the hip?
Hands on hip.
He might have done a hands. I don't even think he never did one in the front at all.
No, right? I don't think so either. No.
No.
Yeah. So when you guys started competing back in the 70s, Tom, did you pose the music or was that later on?
Yeah, we definitely posed the music.
Okay.
It was a little more challenging then because, of course, you couldn't edit music, really. It was hard.
Yeah.
I do remember, like, actually, like, taking a tape and cutting it and splicing it to try and get it, like, because we only had 60 seconds, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
And the song didn't crescendo for, like, 3 minutes. You know what I mean? Like, I got to get this part. I got to get the beginning and this part, right?
Right.
You, like, cut it and you taped it together. Yeah. You hope like hell that it doesn't break in the middle of your performance, you know?
Yeah,
But yeah, we have music, but it was fairly basic at the time.
Okay.
But it did add that choreography a little bit to it, you know what I mean? And again, that's something that even early on I tried to pay attention. I recommend that athletes today pay attention to that choreography, because when you're hitting a pose, it should be punctuated by the music. Not off sync with the music. There's an emotion that comes with a beat. or a word or a song or a melody that come. And if you're off sync, your audience feels that. They know it. They know there's something out of sync. Mm-hmm. So it doesn't register the same way. It doesn't have the same emotional impact. So even then, it was clear to me that, hey, you know what? If I stretch this just for a fraction of a second or a boom, I can hit it on that note instead of like being ahead of it or behind it.
You were learning this as a teenager. It
makes sense to me to do that.
Yeah. Did you notice the other teenagers you were competing with, were they also trying to make an effort and do these good routines?
I think there were a couple of guys. I don't remember a lot of them doing it. But again, like I said, even then, there was either some of the basic posing was even, I mean, everybody made some level of effort for sure. Mm-hmm. But I don't think there was a lot of them like really paying that much attention to it going on, you know? Yeah. There was a couple of guys, Dwayne Broadway, who was competing around that time. He was a great bodybuilder. He was always a very good showman. He played music that was great. And it wasn't so much that he had like really well choreographed routines, but from my recollection, it was just like his excitement, his enthusiasm, and his ability to like dance. I'm sure the guy was like a freaking disco maniac. You know what I mean? Yeah. He was just like, you know how to dance. So he brought that a little bit into the routine, and he played music that was kind of exciting and fun. There was a couple other guys, like some of the guys I remember competing back in those early days, guys like Ron Tufel.
Yeah.
For example, I don't know how many people remember Ron, but he was great.
Yeah.
I think he took second at the Mr. America to Tony Pearson 1 year or something.
He was in it. I think Ron won the Teenage America in 75, and I think he was only 18. And then I think when he was 19, I think he came in the top three in his class at the Mr. America in 76. Yes. I think we were just talking about Pat Nevey. I think Pat might have won his class, and I think Ron might have been second at 19.
Wow.
Yeah, I mean, he was amazing, man. He was great.
I remember, I mean, as a teenager, not to get off subject with the posing, but I remember going to, like, he competed all around my area at many of the same shows.
He was from Pennsylvania, right?
Yeah, and so he was in the Suburban, he was in the Apollo, some of the different shows I competed in, and I don't think I ever competed against him as a teenager. He was always like, thank God. I mean, it just would have been embarrassing, you know what I mean? Ron would have walked off with his tail between. No, I would have been the one in back. But I remember being like dumbfounded by the thickness, you know?
Yeah,
and the density of his muscles, man, you know?
Right.
He never had a pleasing aesthetic physique because he was a little blocky.
Yeah.
But I also remember even Ron, like, again, capitalizing on his physique. Hmm. He knew how to pose for his body.
Yeah.
You know? And he did it well. And I forget, the music also probably complimented it because I remember it being fairly dramatic.
Yeah. So when we go into the 1980s, and I agree with you, I think, maybe I'm biased because that was kind of my era too, you know, and they say you always choose whatever your era is. But
True.
The 1980s to me, it seemed like you said, the physiques had advanced from the 70s and the posing was much improved. But it didn't get too freaky. Like, I think when it got to the 90s, the guys were getting crazy huge, you know. Yeah. But the 80s, it was, like, more relatable, I guess, to the average person. Like, I think if you read Muscle Builder or Muscle and Fitness, a guy could look at, you know, someone like you or Lee Haney even, or Barry DeMay, or, Bob Paris, and say, wow, I want to look like that, you know. And I could look like that if I went to the gym and really worked hard, you know. But the posing was great, so... Do you think the posing was so good in the 80s because a lot of the guys our age were influenced by, like, Pumping Iron and Ed Corney and Arnold?
I think so. You know, again, if you go back to the movie that we were all watching, I mean, I can't imagine anybody, Barry DeMay, I can't imagine like Sean Ray, I mean, Rick Sperry, Lee Haney, everyone was influenced by that movie. And the book, of course, Pumping Iron, the book. Mm-hmm. I love the glimpse into the second aspect of the sport, which is that posing aspect, the presentation, right? They talked about it in the movie. They even have Arnold and Franco in a ballet class being taught by a dancer how to move their body. And it's just like, okay.
The opening scene of the movie, yeah.
Yeah. I mean, how do you not be influenced, whether we acknowledged it or not? It's sort of like watching a really good drama. You know, when the things you remember consciously was the shootout and the fight scene is like, oh, remember that fight scene?
Yeah.
The things that infiltrate our unconscious might be something on a totally different level. And so the first scene, that opening scene in Pumping Iron, infiltrated the unconscious of the would-be, wannabe bodybuilder at that time, and it emphasized the importance of it.
Yeah.
So I think a lot of guys, because if you really look at, and you mentioned, we mentioned a couple of names, if you look at some of the bodybuilding routines, I mean, Bob Parrish's routine, just magnificent. It was designed to emphasize his physique, the art of the sport, the art of posing, to bring the human physique, the sculpture to life.
Yeah.
And it literally did. Sean Ray's posing was just it's magical to watch.
Yeah.
The physique clearly is emphasized and it's magnificent. But the posing, Lee Labrada, again, another 80s graduate into the pro ranks of the 90s. Yeah. Just magnificent posing. And Lee's ability to be able to accentuate his physique. He wasn't the biggest guy on stage. He never was going to be.
Right.
He had a relatively weak set of latissimus muscles. His lats weren't super wide.
Right.
But he knew how to pose to bring out his best. And I don't want to get too ahead of ourselves because this is a slightly, not off topic, but a slightly different component of the topic, which is presence. Presence. Mm-hmm. And if you look at, I mean, everyone posed, and we can talk more about the posing itself and what may, like, the components that go into it, what goes into it, the mindset, the practice levels, what goes into really creating a dynamic posing routine. But more than anything else, and it dawns on me as I'm thinking about, I'm visualizing, you know, Barry DeMay and Rich Gasparri and Lee Labrada and Sean, myself, several others, you know, just like everybody, just like, man, if you watch these guys, there was a presence. A stature and a presence.
Yeah.
Lee Labrada had a tremendous presence on stage at whatever he was, 5'6", 5'7". His presence was enormous.
Yeah.
Lee Haney's had the same presence. Fortunately, he was a bigger individual anyway. But it was the presence, the stature that these bodybuilders brought to the stage and then sort of transferred through their posing routines that created the dynamic that existed then that we're having a hard time seeing as much of today, I think.
Yeah, yeah. So if you go back to the beginning of the 80s, I'm thinking like McAway from the 80,
fantastic.
82, 83 Olympia. I remember Olympia. That was shown on NBC Wide World of Sports. And I mean, even like the most hardcore rugged bodybuilders would be so impressed by that guy. I mean, he posed the Chariots of Fire, I think, and it was just the way he moved his arms and the way, I mean, it was like magic, man. It was just Now McAway was a guy who was like 5'2", winning pro shows, and I think a lot of it was because of the posing.
Mr. Universe, ladies and gentlemen, Muhammad from Magical Egyptian, Muhammad.
Thank you.
Absolutely. And it goes back to that stature thing again, that presence on stage. It's almost like, and I'd love to talk a little bit about the mindset as we progress a little bit further into the conversation, because the mindset of how to create that kind of presence on stage, when the stakes are high, you might say, you know?
But
his posing, he was so impressive. And he had a look, you know, he just had a great, like the whole package was there, the look. He wasn't a big guy by any means. But you're right, the posing, and it's just, you know, and it's interesting because I think a lot of people who've never seen Muhammad Macaway standing next to someone else mm-hmm. might never know he was only 5'2 or 5'3.
Yeah. You know? No, you would never know.
I'm only 5'8. I remember being in Germany at the FIBO, and some big giant German guy comes up to me and I'm signing autographs, and he's like, "Tom Terwilliger, I thought you'd be much bigger." So it's like, it's the illusion.
Yeah.
And the posing really, it just was captivating to watch.
Yeah. And if you look at McAway's career, I mean, he started off, he won the Universe in 1976. And then I remember going to a lot of those Frank Zane Olympias in the late 70s in Columbus. Yeah. And McAway was in a lot of those shows. And he didn't do well. He would place like 7th or 8th.
Wow.
He was off, you know. And then he started working with Vince Gironda. Mm-hmm. Vince Gironda told him like how to get ripped, but also told him how to pose.
Yep.
So when he came back in the early 80s, man, that guy was a totally different bodybuilder. He was more ripped, but like you said, he had that presence, and he was winning pro shows, taking second in the Olympia 2 times in a row.
Yeah.
5'2". I mean, that's inconceivable. 5 foot two.
Unbelievable. And yeah, I'll tell you what, Vince Gironda, a name popped in my head, and I don't want to make sure I'm not remiss in not mentioning him, because another guy who was a great poser, but I want to go back to Vince Gironda for a second, because that, again, supersedes even, you know, all of the bodybuilders from the 80s who came from the 70s, where Vince Gironda was really an influence, you know?
Yeah.
But I do want to make sure, maybe we can bring him up again later, but Samir Banute, you know, I love Samir, and we did a Grand Prix tour together, and we went to a couple of different events, you know, post-competition together, and I just really kind of, he was a crazy son of a bitch. But I love him. I just love the guy. And in fact, you and I ran into you for the first time in person, along with Samir.
Yeah.
You guys were like, entertaining an audience, quite the audience.
At the old school labs booth, yeah.
At the right. That's right, at the Olympia a year or two ago. So I want to make sure that it's impossible to overlook him, but when a name pops into my head, I have to mention it, because he's such an artful poser, and just, again, you're being able to, you know, maximize his physique with the type of posing he was doing. But let's talk about Vince Gironda for a minute. Wouldn't that have been an experience? Because if you look at early Vince Gironda's, and who knows really how to pronounce his name, for God's sake. But some of the early poses, I mean, that guy was early on doing the open hands,
yeah.
and the twisting back shots and the stuff like that. I mean, he was thin, but he was great. And
very,
I can
very
imagine,
aesthetic too, very ripped and very aesthetic.
Very aesthetic, yeah. I can imagine working, and he worked with some great champions, man. He worked with some great guys.
Well, it's funny too, when you go back in the history, I remember Corney told me that he was influenced, not told me, but I remember reading in the magazines, he said that he was influenced by Leo Stern, and Leo Stern used to teach Bill Pearl how to pose.
Really?
Yeah. So then Corney's influenced by Leo Stern, and then I'm sure like guys like Chris Dickerson were influenced by Ed Corney, and then McAway was probably influenced by Dickerson.
Yeah, absolutely.
And I know Lee Labrada said he was influenced by McAway. So it's crazy how when you've got these guys who are great posers, people coming up, the younger guys, the new generation, they're influenced by those guys. And maybe that's the problem today, is these guys today don't have influences. They don't have anybody to be influenced by.
Yeah, I think we've gotten away from that. I think there's because again, usually the influence is the generation before.
Yeah.
So if you look at, obviously, Bill Pearl and Leo, what was Leo's last name?
Leo Stern.
Leo Stern. I remember Leo Stern. Again, the generation or two before. And then McAway just before. Lee Labrada starts to climb the ladder. So you're right. A lot of the athletes today don't have that just previous generation.
Yeah.
Because even if you look at, you know, Phil Heath, if you look at Jay Cutler, I mean, you know, okay, they unbelievable physiques. There's no denying.
Yeah, for
you
sure.
You know what I mean? But I don't think there was a tremendous effort put forth in terms of the routines.
Yeah.
And I don't think the routines ever change. I may be wrong. And again, forgive me, guys, if I am wrong. But a lot of times too, and this is interesting because I had a conversation with a top female Miss Olympia competitor not long ago.
Okay.
And I told her, and this was actually about a year and a half ago. And it was just before last year's Olympia. And I asked her, I said, well, what do you think your weakness is? She said, well, my legs have to come up. I said, yeah, they're starting to come up. They could use a little work, but you can hide some of that a little bit too. And she says, my posing could be a little better. And the women posers are fantastic.
Right.
And you can't afford a top fitness, a Miss Olympia competitor cannot afford to have her routine anything but any second best. You cannot be second best, right?
Right, right.
And so I challenged her. I said, here's my challenge to you. I said, well, of course I asked her, I said, so how much effort do you put in? Well, not really. I pretty much do the same thing every year. Or I kind of wing it, you know, based on my music. I said, you really think that's good enough? You're at the Olympia level and that's good enough? She said, well, probably not. I said, well, here's my challenge to you. My challenge is that you put 2-3 hours at least a week. Number one, develop a new routine. And if you have to get a choreographer. Develop the new routine and put at least 2-3 hours a week into mastering that routine. So when you get on stage, it's second nature.
Yeah.
Right?
Right.
So I challenged her to do that. Unfortunately, it fell on deaf ears because she didn't do it. And she said she would. Okay. I'm going to step up to that challenge. She didn't do it. And I can't say as a result, but it's certainly her performance, which was familiar and comfortable, didn't cut it.
Yeah.
Where it might have, you know what, if the judges had said, you know, oh my God, that routine just blew us away. And as a result, you stepped up.
Yeah.
We saw. And that might have made a difference. And so the reason I bring that up is because I think that's what's happening a lot with today's generation.
Yeah.
Do the same thing again and again. One of the things, and again, Sean Ray, we never mentioned Vince Taylor's brilliance on stage as far as his posing, another coming up to the ranks in the 80s. Never really did, maybe once or twice for guest posing, they would repeat routines.
Yeah.
But almost very rarely would come back with the identical routine they did last year.
At a show, yeah. You know? Right.
Right? The physique has changed a little bit. The routine changes a little bit.
Yeah.
So you don't rest on your laurels.
The women bodybuilders, because I did an interview with Corey Everson, and Corey said every year she won her 6 Miss Olympias, she worked really, really hard on a new routine. And it was expected of her that she come in with this great routine. And if you remember the women bodybuilders from the 1980s, they all had great routines.
Oh.
They were all amazing. You know,
I
think learned a lot from them.
Absolutely. I might want to actually go back and say that was one of my influences as well.
Yeah.
You know, and there's a lot that went into, you know, developing the routines along the way and wanting to have those kind of routines. You know, for me personally, was being around a lot of the female bodybuilders. I was around a lot in the 80s. I did a World Mixed Pairs Championship with Gladys Portuguese, who was one of the top females. And, you know, just one of the sweetest gals you'll ever meet in your life, you know, and just a great gal. And so we worked on a routine together. And then I got to see... As a result of that, I got to see and meet a lot of these, you know, the top female competitors and watch those routines. And in my mind, it's just like, why aren't we doing routines like that?
Right, right.
We got to do, why can't we bring as much magic, you know?
Yeah,
I'm glad you brought that up because that, now that I think about it, that was an influence without question.
Yeah. And also, as you mentioned earlier about hiding your weak points, you know, like you're talking about Lee Labrada didn't have the biggest back. I remember one of the routines, I think it was the 84 Olympia when McAway got second, and Frank Zane was doing the commentating, and he said, if you notice, like, McAway has weak hamstrings, he's got a weak back, but you'll never see it in his routine because he was emphasizing his arms, his triceps, the sweeping poses. You know, when he did a back shot, it was never a straight-on back shot.
Never.
His weaker back, he would do a twisting back shot, and then your eyes went to his shoulders and his triceps, you know.
Yeah, do you remember ever seeing a like a regular straight on back double bicep or even a front double bicep from McCowrie? I don't know if I've ever seen a prejudging, but I don't remember ever seeing a straight on just boom. Right.
Not in his routine,
never.
And Zane was talking about how he did all these hand movements, and it was like a magician, you know. Taking the emphasis away from his weak points and putting him on his strong points, you know.
Exactly. Yeah. And the hand movements, And again, one of the components of bringing forth a good routine is coordinating the body together. You know, not just bringing the arms up, but when the hands move, how do they flow up? And again, it doesn't always have to be a Macaue or what I used to do with the hands, like a Qigong type thing or Kung Fu thing. It could be something a little bit different, but it should be like the whole body. If you turn the arm, the hip should turn.
Yeah.
The head should move. Your toes, your feet, whatever it might be, there's a shift. There's a subtle shift in everything. I mean, if you picture like, you know, remember the old robotic type routines where you just like everything would just like a little turn here or there, you know what I mean? And so working on that takes a little effort.
Yeah.
The best turn? What's the best quarter? What's the best hand movement, you know?
Well, Corney had those great hand movements. Oh. And the way he moved his arms, you know.
Oh, the open palm, the open hand thing. Just like bring it up. And that's what you were watching. And then all of a sudden, it's like, boom, he's in this pose.
Yeah.
You were watching the movement and the dynamic of the movement. And then suddenly it's boom. Yeah. There it is. You know?
Yeah, I saw the 77 Olympia when Ed got like two or three standing ovations. That was the year Pumping Iron came out, as you mentioned.
Right.
And then by the time the Olympia came around, everybody knew Corney was the master poser. Yeah. And he killed it. And he was in great shape. He got third place that year. But he killed it with the posing. And then I remember in the next year, I was really impressed in 78. I thought I did an interview with Roger Schwab, who was the head judge at the Olympia that year. And he thought Ed was a little bit off that year because Ed only took, I think, seventh, you know, dropping from third. But yeah. I thought in 78, I thought he looked great. He was thicker. Maybe his conditioning was a little bit off. But I remember his routine was amazing because he combined these really majestic movements with his arms. And then he would just like hit a most muscular part, you know.
Yeah.
It was just so great the way he did it all. I mean, you tell the amount of practice that guy put in must have been incredible, you know.
Well, the practice must have been amazing. But it is that dichotomy between the slow and then boom, suddenly there's this power.
Yeah.
You know, it's like a slow motion punch, and then all of a sudden, an inch from your face, it's like you're faster. You couldn't even see it happen. It's like suddenly you got hit.
They didn't even post the music back then. I mean, that was just, he just got up and posed, and the crowd was crazy. Yeah. The only music was the applause, you know.
Yeah. Just a minute. Yeah, I remember even in Pumping Iron. Remember when Corney's posing?
Yeah.
And they're sitting in the audience, Robbie Robinson and Danny Padilla and Arnold Schwarzenegger. And I was like, now that is posing. Right. And I'm like, you're damn freaking right it is.
And speaking of Corney, too, I remember how he said that when he practiced the pose, everything had to be perfect. The way his hands pointed, the way everything was lined up. Because if one little thing was off, like if your foot was a little bit off or your knee was a little bit off. And I remember John Brown said this, too. Mm. It ruins the whole pose.
You know, I agree.
It's got to all be perfect, you know. Yep. Like, so, and I think
nothing worse than that twisting back.
Yeah.
One arm is like down like this. Yeah. Just like, no.
Yeah, it ruins it. It ruins the whole thing.
The elbow has got to be completely in line with the other elbow, you know. Yeah. And but that takes practice. And I don't know. I think we've lost that ability to be able to put that much time and effort into. Because I can remember doing poses, and I've been very blessed to have had coaches, but also training partners. One of my absolute favorites, best training partners, Ron Starantino, who became a celebrity agent. He's been on and did a lot for Sons of Anarchy and several other shows, including The Apprentice. He was one of my best training partners ever. Very successful guy. And I remember when we would work on those routines, so like that Olympia routine, the 89 Olympia routine, that was my training partner. And man, that guy, this is something, advice for anyone and everyone in the sport, in any sport for that matter. Don't surround yourself by the brocebos. And what I mean by the brocebos is, you know what the placebo effect is, right? It's like you can convince yourself that a medication is working or something like that, right? The brocebos can convince you look better than you are. And they're like, oh, bro, you look fucking great, man. You look awesome. You're looking to win this thing. You know what I mean? You're winning, you get crushed.
Right.
And then you're crushed. You'd rather have honesty. You know what I mean? So Ronnie would just like tear me apart, man. He would tear me apart. He's like, no. Turn that hand. You know what I mean? He's like, bring it up. I could see it. But I needed like, just like tap the elbow, you know?
Yeah.
And I was like, man. And it was annoying as hell. But ultimately, it got into the cells and you remembered it. You remember where it's supposed to be and exactly how it is. The little things, and you know this, John, I mean, just like you hit that ab shot, there's a specific way of hitting your particular ab shot that brings out that serratus, and there's a way of doing it that it doesn't bring it out.
Right.
And if you don't get it right through hours and hours of practice, guess what? It ain't coming out on stage. It's just not.
Right.
And therefore, you're not going to be a best on stage. That's the bottom line.
Right. Yeah, you're right. You really need somebody there to critique your body, because you can't, even if you're looking in the mirror, you can't really see it all. I remember when I was getting ready for like the teenage shows I did, my younger brother, he was 1 year younger than me. He was studying art classes. He became a commercial artist. So it was really great how he saw the body aesthetically. And he would say, no, move your arm this way or twist your arm this way. It looks better.
Yeah.
Your waist looks smaller. You know, he could see the body from an artistic viewpoint.
Absolutely. And it's fascinating you bring that up, because again, my training partner, Ronnie, was very instrumental in that. But earlier on was my brother, my twin brother, Mike, who became a great bodybuilder, won the Tri-State and the Metropolitan Championship, was on his way to going to the Nationals. I remember being in the basement, because he's an artist. He's an airbrush artist. He's a tattoo artist, and just probably one of the most brilliant artists. This art, I don't know how much you can see of it behind me. He did both those pieces in airbrush. It's really good. And he would do the same thing down in my basement when I was a teenager, early 20s. He would do the same thing. And you got to twist it, turn that off. I'm not seeing that teres major. Whatever it might be, you know, we got to know the anatomy pretty well. And when you know the anatomy and you know it should be there, but we're not seeing it, you're either fat or you're not bringing it out, period. Yeah. And he was really instrumental in that early on. I remember that, man. I was very fortunate.
And like you said, the practice time, I remember, you know, same as you, I did the shows in the early 80s, and we would I'd get my cassette tape ready, and you practice over and over. It was almost like, you know, you went to the gym 6 days a week, and you had to practice your posing 6 days a week.
I mean, you had to practice.
And sometimes you didn't feel like it. You're dieting and stuff, but you had to get in your posing trunks and get in front of the mirror and practice, practice, practice. And that's the only way you got good at it.
I remember that. And again, you know, we honored Bob Gruskin a few weeks back, and God rest his soul, one of the great mentors and coaches of all time. And I think somebody talked about it. It might have been Jerry Scalise was talking about that. You would get in front of that mirror, that puny little mirror that he had down in his basement. And for like what felt like an eternity, man.
Yeah.
It was like, oh my God. And you know, nobody really wanted to do it. We wanted to be critiqued, you know what I mean? But it's just like, he was brilliant at that, man. So yeah. I guess there's a lot of people I have to credit, including Bob, for running you through. And the other thing that it did is just like, hey, when you're standing in front of Bob Gruskin's mirror and you're posing and you're having to go through it and you're having to turn the leg in a little bit or turn the leg out a little bit to show that hamstring, flex the glute, whatever it might be that needs to be done. It set up the rule. The rule is you get in front of that mirror and you spend freaking hours. That's it.
Yeah.
You're a bodybuilder. You're an artist. You're doing a sculpture. If you're doing a sculpture, you know, and you're not stepping back down again to critique it and to take a look at it and see what's missing, what needs to happen next. How do I do this? Or how do I change that? How do I make it exactly what I want? Then you're missing. You're missing something. And so you have to be able to do that. And I think that's an important part. Not to mention, and you know this, John, that the closer you get to competition, number one, you need the conditioning of standing there posing, because there's no relaxing. You know, when you're on stage, right? You're not relaxing. You can't relax. And so you're always semi-flex, always holding and showing your best. And I remember Bob Gruskin telling me that. He was like, the minute you breathe out and your gut goes out, or the minute you relax, that's when the judges are going to see you.
Right.
And that's what's going to hold in their mind.
Yeah.
He said, you can never let them see you like that. You always have to be semi-flex. And then you got to go through your turns and your quarters and your poses and everything else. So you had better be in posing condition.
Yeah.
You don't have to run a marathon, but it's equivalent to a marathon.
Yeah.
And you better be in shape for it. And the only way to get in shape for it is not training, not working out. It's posing itself to be able to hold that, you know, and the breathing.
It seems like, Tom, there was just a feeling among, and again, we're going back to the 80s. When you went to a contest and you're sitting in the audience as a competitor and you're watching other people pose, you had the responsibility of doing a good posing routine. You may not be McAway, you may not be Ed Corney, but you had to do at least make the effort of doing a good routine, good transitions. Mm-hmm. And if you got music, it's got to be coordinated to the music. And if you didn't, like, you kind of lost respect, I think, among all the other competitors, you know?
Yeah, you know what? You bring up a good point, and that's exactly right. We did feel like there was a responsibility.
Yeah.
It was part of the deal. You know what I mean? Yeah. It was a part of the deal. You just had to do it. That's who you were.
Right.
And that's, as an athlete, that was a component of being a champion. And you're right. You didn't want to let down. Man, last thing I'd ever want to hear was getting on stage by another competitor saying, hey, you're in great shape, but your routine, what the frig happened to your routine, man?
Right.
You know, you can't. It's back then, Tim Belknap would have come up to me and said, what's this about? You freaking earn that. You don't ask for it.
Right.
You earn it. You don't demand the audience applaud you.
Yeah.
And that might have worked once, but it's gotten old.
Oh, yeah.
He would have been like, that's ridiculous, man. You're dishonoring the audience by doing that. You know?
Well, before I let you go, Tom, I want to talk to you about your 89 Olympia. How many times did you do the Olympia? Was it just that one time or was it
more? No, twice. I did it 89 and 91.
Oh, 91, right. Okay.
Yep.
So 89 in Rimini, Italy was the one you did where you did all the pantomime and it was almost like a movie.
Mm.
How did you come up with that? Tell me about that.
You know, if I would track it down, I would say that routine in 91, which was also something that, again, I tried to get completely out of the box with.
Okay.
What
was the one where you did where it was like you're pushing up or you're coming down?
Yeah, no, I had not been knocked down and I had to just wait and I did like come up with the weight.
Right.
And I got shot with a machine gun. It was like, I was telling some kind of crazy story.
Right.
Which I don't even remember to this day what it was. But much of that on both occasions were inspired by the music.
Okay.
The music. And because of, you know, the years of practice and being on stage. And the other thing that kind of led up to some of that was much of the drama that I was able to learn as a performer in Manhattan.
Mm.
I was performing with a group called, it was called Muscle Opera.
Huh.
And we had an opportunity to, it was myself, Gladys Portuguese, Nick Ballow, Ming Chu, who was a great bodybuilder at the time, chiropractor today. Brian Moss, who owned Better Bodies at the time and Better Bodies Model Management. It got me a lot of, I did a lot of commercial work in New York at that time.
Okay.
But we had this and Carla Dunlap, which is the Miss Olympia. We had this group and we would literally perform at all these nightclubs, the top nightclubs in Manhattan.
Wow. Okay.
And yeah, it was pretty spectacular. We did some cool stuff. We did some Roman gladiator stuff.
I remember seeing pictures of that. Yeah.
Yeah. It was cool. It was fun, but you couldn't just get up there and just do a, you know, like a muscle routine. It was a performance. It was an act, you know?
Okay. Okay.
And so much of the drama that I would bring into the routine was inspired by that. And that I was also very fortunate that gave me so much like practice, stage practice.
Yeah.
And allowed me, doing nightclub stuff, allowed me to be a little bit more daring, a little bit more risque, a little bit more adventurous, you might say, in the routines.
Mm-hmm.
So I had a chance to really kind of work them things out. And so, that helped a lot. But the music for me has always been the key.
Okay.
And so one of the things that I've always done is this, if I hear back then anyway, and even to this day, I still, you know, there's certain things that happen today that like are still part of my past. Number one, I drive past a great building that is empty. I'm like, oh man, that would make a great gym. I'm not opening another freaking gym. You know what I mean? I'm like, but boy, that would be a great gym if I was, you know what I mean? So that still happens. And also when I hear a piece of music, and usually it's not commercial music, usually, and both those routines from 89 and 91 was music inspired by movies.
Mm.
91 was the soundtrack a part of. I blended it with another piece of music, but it was part of the soundtrack from Black Rain.
Mm, okay.
And so when I would hear something, and I'd be like, ooh. And then I think I mixed that with something from the movie Lost Boys. Interestingly enough, and I don't want to bore you with this, but interestingly enough, the piece that I did from Lost Boys was a heavy saxophone piece with some singing and some lyrics as well about being cast off at sea and in the waves and having to hold on to this hope and fighting for like survival almost, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
And the ultimate words was, I still believe.
Right, I remember that, yeah.
Interestingly enough, that song was performed and the sax was performed by a guy, and I believe his first name was Brian. I can't remember his second name, but he was part of the Muscle Opera group that when we toured and did things in Manhattan, and he used to pull out, he had a live saxophone. He was very muscular, long hair. He was a saxophone player for Tina Turner, but he would perform with us and he would pull out his sax and he'd just like play his sax. I was like, I thought it was a prop. Holy crap, the guy's unbelievable. It's just amazing, right? So years later, one of his pieces of music was in the movie Lost Boys. I pulled that piece, not because it was his, but just coincidentally. So I pulled that piece, I blended it with another piece, and then I would just listen to it and listen to it and listen to it. And the music itself moved me. It was like, it inspired. It felt like an emotion coming up.
Right, right.
And I knew this is the emotion. This is what I want other people to feel. I want them to feel this. So how do I bring that to life? How do I tell a story with that? And so I let the music evolve into the storytelling. And it was ultimately about someone who had been suppressed and held down and felt like the world was coming down on him. And ultimately, I even had someone do a recording that you've been found guilty by the high tribunal and sentenced to death. And I'm being like, I'm being electrocuted, right?
Yeah.
And then I'm reborn.
Yeah.
I wind up reborn. And that's when the I Believe song comes in. And it's a whole nother story. It's the rebirth.
Yeah.
The storytelling is a big part of it. But for me, it evolved as a result of the music. When I listened to the music, I could see it. I could feel it.
Yeah.
You know, and we've all done that. We've all had music where you close your eyes and heroic images or past images, things start to come up. And so if you translate that into how does that look on stage? How would I look doing this or that? And start to create the visualization process. Naturally evolves. Of course, you know, once you put it into practice, it's almost like a designer, a home. Like if I'm a designer, right, and I designed this magnificent home, now I got to give it to the engineers, and they're like, this is impossible. We can't build this. So now all of a sudden I get into the mirror, in front of the mirror, and it's just like, all these images I had, all this picture I had in my mind, how do I translate that? How do I put the mechanics into it to turn it into a routine?
Yeah.
And so really that was, you know, the music becomes the inspiration. I think that's something more bodybuilders need to look at today.
Yeah.
Get away from the commercial music that everyone's listening to and playing, and find something that moves you. Movie music is designed specifically for that.
Right, right.
It's designed to create a mood, to create suspense and drama and elevate or take us down. And so why not capitalize on that? It's foolish not to, in my opinion.
Yeah. I remember going back to the 70s, Boyer Cole, he had a great closing routines back in the late 70s.
I love Boyer.
Yeah. And he would use Rocky sometimes. But he always told me, or I read in the magazines, Boyer would say, music is an emotion. So it should move you. And when you pose, you know, you should pick something that's inspiring.
Mm-hmm.
And then I did an interview with Lee Haney. And Lee talked about the first time he won the Mr. Olympia, he used the music from Excalibur, the movie Excalibur, about Arthur. And he said the reason he used that was when you see the movie, there's a part in the movie where King Arthur comes back to life and the country comes back to life. And it's like, oh, there's a new king now. And that's he wanted to convey to the audience that there's a new king now. I'm the new king. Yep. So it's amazing that he thought about that and he used that music and then he designed a routine. Remember that one part where he goes down and he's had his arms out. And then when he came up, that's when he used the music from Excalibur and he used a different piece of music. And that was the message he wanted to convey. So it's great when you get so into it like you did, you know, and I still believe that that's a great message to come across. Bodybuilders can relate to that. You know, it's about believing in yourself. And
absolutely. And there's going to be trials and tribulations and challenges and setbacks, you know, but you cannot stop believing. And so that piece of music was just, it just moved me. And I think my brother had posed to it or another song. No, it was actually a different song. It was a song by Greg Allman that he posed to 1 year. And again, that moved me, his posing to that. And I think I used that Greg Allman song, and that might have been from Black Rain later. That was in 91 or so. And again, so the music has to move you. If the music doesn't move you, it's just something that you think. If you're doing music or something just because it's popular, because you think the audience is going to like it,
right,
it doesn't mean it's right for you. It doesn't mean it's going to move the audience.
No.
And it's not going to necessarily convey your message. And I think ultimately, since I know we got to come to a close and I want to respect your time, ultimately it is about, number one, going back to presence, being completely authentic, and being able to convey a message that is your authentic self. Who are you? Because people say, you know, it's like, oh, it's too difficult. It's hard to put together a routine and then just, man, it's so nerve-wracking to try. It's like, if I just go up there and do this, it's easier. You know what I mean? Sure, it's difficult. But if you want to be something more than what anybody else is, if you want to rise to the top, then you got to be willing to do what's difficult and what no one else is doing.
Yeah.
And to do that, that means being authentic, being your best authentic self.
Yeah.
And to do that, you have to be able to convey your message and you have to be comfortable and you've got to be certain about yourself on stage to be able to convey that message. When you can convey that message, this is who I am. Take me or leave me. I'm not going to change for anyone else. This is who I am. I believe in myself. I'm strong in that conviction. And you present that, my God, I'm telling you, man, I don't care how good or bad you are as a bodybuilder, the audience will be sold on your story.
Right.
And you will win them over. I've won over audiences. I don't mean to blow my own horn, but I've won over audiences that I didn't even place in the top 10.
Yeah.
I didn't place in the top 10 of Olympia, but I got a standing ovation.
Yeah.
And I got invited to do the Grand Prix and do these, I mean, just dozens and dozens of guest posting for that reason.
Right.
That reason only. Otherwise, I could have went home with my tail between my legs and that would have been it, you know?
And as a bodybuilder, I mean, we have to be motivated to go to the gym. I mean, there's got to be, you know, it takes years of effort to build a physique. So that motivation has to come from somewhere. And when you see a movie like Rocky, I just saw that movie Rudy on TV again last week.
Oh, man.
I mean, it just moves you so much because this kid was so motivated to, you know, and as bodybuilders, we're motivated. Yeah. In order to build our physiques, there's going to be times when we don't want to go to the gym. And we got to find that motivation. And then getting ready for a show is twice as hard. Because now you're dieting, so when you get up there, you should convey that motivation. You should convey that willpower, you know, to the audience.
Yeah.
And if you can find a way to do that, I mean.
Absolutely. And again, part of it is conveying your authentic self, but also realizing, and this was Perry Powell for me, because again, any competition I've ever been in, regardless of the routine or the level of the competition in many respects, was I always had in the back of my mind that I'm that kid sitting in the audience watching Ed Corney.
Yeah.
How inspired. Yeah. And the difference, I got to tell you, John, the difference that made in my life, I was on a very bad path. And without that difference in mindset and motivation and inspiration, I don't know what would have happened.
Wow. I'd
be riding with some outlaws or dead today. Yeah. And so when I think about that, it's just like, it should be more than just about the muscle. It should be the presence. It should be who you are. And I think, guys, this goes all the way. This goes deeper. The routine is a message. It's your story in many respects and how you want to tell that story. But more importantly than anything else, let's go back to presence again, because presence has to do with how you care about everyone else and how you care about yourself and the message that you're conveying to the fans and to the other people who may be inspired by the sport or what you're doing at the level you're doing it. And I think we have to become great curators of that we have other people's, not to sound arrogant, but we have other people's hearts and minds that we're responsible for in many respects.
Yeah.
And we have to know that we have the ability to inspire or crush. We can either let someone down or we can build them up.
Yeah.
Sometimes all it takes is a reaching out, a handshake. Hey, kid, you look good. Or, oh, sure, of course I'll sign that. Or having a routine that says, hear me so we can hear you. Because I think it was Marion Williamson said that if we allow our own light to shine, we give others permission to shine with us.
Yeah.
Be their authentic self. So that's what I would call upon athletes and bodybuilders today to do. To shine as bright as possible, to reach out, know you have the ability to inspire, and you may change some lives.
Yeah.
I know that sounds like a big responsibility, but you got a freaking, the ability to be able to change someone's life, man.
Yeah.
Alter their path, alter their destiny. And you can do it through your routine and your respect for them and your love for them as an audience member and a fan.
And if you want to be a bodybuilder, it's about the art and sport of bodybuilding. So you have to show the art part of the too, you know.
Absolutely right, man. And you always did that, John. That's why I enjoyed being on with you, man. I have tremendous respect for what you've been able to do, especially, and again, in, you know, the natural bodybuilding community, you are a freaking single powerhouse, man. What you've been able to do and be able to rise above circumstances and not have any excuses. I didn't do this, I didn't do that, and that's why. No. You became a great champion regardless. And so that in itself is inspiring, man. And I was still that teenage kid, I'd be picking up some weights tomorrow because of you, man.
Oh, thank you.